Just remain standing with me if you will, and as we come back together, God bless you. We fellowship together. Miss Deborah's going to give a testimony about what the Lord did for her this week, and then we'll get in the Word together.
Well, y'all all know I got my inheritance in 2012, and Christmas time the Lord told me to bless all the ministers that Christmas, and it was a blessing. And so this Christmas I thought, well, Lord, what can I do this time? The Lord didn't prompt me to do this, and I got to thinking about the wise men. It said they opened up their treasuries and they gave gifts to baby Jesus. And that's what God wants to do with you and I. He wants to open up the treasure that He's put in us, that we'll be givers. Amen? That we'll give. So Sunday, I just prompted in my heart, I purposed in my heart to give to all the ministers. Well, before I left my house, I had locked myself out of my house. Now, the carnal mind would say, put that money back in your pocket, because you're going to need it, because you're going to need it to get a key made from the locksmith. And I didn't even reason. I thought, Lord, I'm going to bless, and I'm going to be a blessing. And I'd already purposed what I... So I gave my gifts, and before I left Sunday, somebody walked by me and gave me a roll of money. And it was all the money I gave Sunday morning. You can't outgive Him. I don't care what you do. You can't outgive the Lord. So just thank God.
Amen. Praise God. All right, let's say it together. We're a family church, a Bible training center. We're changing Lancaster, South Carolina. And we're excited about Jesus. Hallelujah. Our vision is Jesus Christ. Our mission is to preach, teach, and exalt the Lord Jesus Christ in all the fullness of His glory and power, and to radiate His love to our community and unto all the world. Amen. Living, breathing epistles of the life of God. Please be mindful this week of the schedule and what we're doing, and be in prayer as we transition, because we know that just changing the calendar date will not change your life. If it did, everybody's life would be changed. Not one person will get to remain in 2015. When we come to Thursday night and pass into Friday morning, 2015 is gone. No one gets to stay there. So if just changing the calendar date, turn over a new year, a new leaf, a new life, that's not going to change your life. But the gospel will, and the seed you sow will change your life. The gospel of grace will change your life. So I bless you in Christ. I honor you in Christ as the family. We've had a good year, a long year, but a good year. And we've seen favor and blessing, and it's been a time of advancement. So let's pray together, and then we'll get in Father's Word. Father, thank You for Your Word. Thank You that You speak clearly to us. You build, You edify, You equip us. You strengthen us with Your Word. We receive abundant grace today and the gift of Your righteousness to heal and to bless, to strengthen. And as we preach and teach on healing of the body, thank You that diseases leave our body, that health comes. Health is both ministered and it's manifested in our body. It's multiplied in our congregation. We agree. Seed sown on good ground produces good fruit to Your glory and the spreading of Your gospel. We thank You for it, trust You in it, and we give You honor and praise in the mighty and worthy name of Jesus. And we said together, amen. All right, children, young people, you may go with your classes and your teachers and your staff. And God bless you this morning. If you will, you can turn to the book of Acts chapter 3. Where we'll begin this morning, Acts chapter 3. Before church, Reese has got glitter all over her skirt, and I picked up Reese, and I looked down at my coat. I thought the glory of God had manifested. I said, praise God, what a day it's going to be. I've got glory everywhere. I'm glowing. Oh, that's glitter off Reese's skirt. One preacher wasn't paying any attention, and he got so excited, and he was reading his Bible, and he kept looking around for his glasses, and then he decided to try to read his Bible anyway, and he read, and he could read, and he started shouting, and God had healed him, and his wife kept going, the glasses are on your face, they're on your face, they're on your face. He forgot he's wearing his glasses. So preachers make mistakes sometimes, don't they? Well, praise God. We're studying being heirs of God, joint heirs with Christ, how privileged we are, how blessed we are to be an heir of God and a joint heir with the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm one with Him. All that's His belongs to me. I'm a new creature in Christ. I'm blood washed and redeemed. I'm free. I'm full. I'm blessed of the Lord and highly favored. So are you. cleansed and washed, sins removed, standing in the presence of a holy God without any fear of judgment or reprisal for what I have done. Jesus bore all of my death, curse, and sin. I receive all of his life and blessing. I am healed today and free and strengthened. And God wants to minister to us spirit, soul, and body. And in our inheritance, he has given us both full right and privilege to use the mighty name of Jesus. And every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. That name is exalted. He by inheritance has obtained that name. We are intimate through marriage in that name. And then we've been instructed to mature. And now we're looking at impartation and ministry. We have the ministry of prayer in his name, the ministry of praise and giving thanks in his name. And now again this morning I want to talk to you about physical healing and the name of Jesus. God wants you well. God wants you healed. The old covenant picture of it, there's not one feeble one among their tribe, Psalms 105:37. I believe among Open Doors tribe, there's not one feeble one among us. That everybody here who comes here is healed, is blessed, is strengthened, and is radically blessed in their physical body. That I pray above all things you be in health and prosper, even as your soul prospers. 3 John verse 2. So I want us to again look at faith in the name of Jesus, and then we're going to sound these trumpets of healing. Let's read Acts chapter 3 and Acts chapter 4, just these portions of Scripture together with understanding. Let the Word of God speak to our heart. Acts chapter 3, verse 1, "Now Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour. And a certain man lame from his mother's womb was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of them that entered into the temple, who seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, ask an alms. And Peter, fastening his eyes upon him with John, said, Look on us. And he gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something of them. And then Peter said, Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee. In the name of all healings to be ministered in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And he took him by the right hand, extended favor to him, and lifted him up, and immediately his feet and his ankle bones received strength. Now notice, he received strength. The inward work was the mending and fixing of the bone. The outward work was the work done in his feet. Internal and external work was done. He received. Notice he had to receive this. This is something you have to receive. It's given freely, but you still have to receive it. The gift is of no consequence or value if you don't receive it. Salvation is offered to every man freely, but you have to receive it. And his ankle bones received strength. And he, leaping up, walked and entered in with them into the temple, walking, leaping, and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God. And they knew it was he which set for alms at the beautiful gate of the temple, and they were filled with wonder and amazement at that which had happened unto them. And as the lame man which was healed held Peter and John, and all the people ran together unto them in the porch that is called Solomon's, greatly wondering, Peter saw it. He answered unto the people, You men of Israel, why marvel ye at this? And then notice again, he says, Why look you so earnestly on us? Now he told the lame man, look on us. He told the crowd, look away from us. Why do you look so earnestly on us as though by our own power or holiness we made this man to walk? Verse 13, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and of Jacob, the God of our fathers, and here's the purpose of all healing and demonstrations of God's grace, mercy, and power, hath glorified his son Jesus. Healing was not just designed to relieve human suffering, but designed to glorify Jesus, to confirm the gospel and exalt his name, and let men see the glory and wonder of who Jesus is. God hath glorified his son Jesus, whom you delivered up and denied him in the presence of Pilate when he was determined to let him go. You denied the Holy One and the just, and desired a murder be granted unto you, that being Barabbas by name, and killed the Prince of Life, whom God raised from the dead, whereof we are witnesses. That's the gospel. The Prince of Life was killed. All of us had part in Jesus' death. Jesus died because of my sin, your sin, our sin. Jesus died. We killed the Prince of Life, but God raised Him from the dead. God was unwilling to leave His Son dead. He raised Jesus from the dead, whereof we are witnesses. In verse 16, this is a great anthem in the healing gospel. And His name, Jesus. And His name, the Lord Jesus Christ. And His name, Jesus, the Son of God. And His name, Christ our Lord. And His name. Now notice, through faith in His name. 1 John chapter 3, verse 23, we are commanded to believe on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is His commandment, that you believe on the name of His Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another as He gave commandment. The new covenant commandment is to believe on the name of Jesus. Romans 10, 13, whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Through faith in His name hath made this man strong. So if faith in His name could make this man strong and change his condition, which was over a 40-year period, this man was over 40 years old, according to our record, and faith in the name of Jesus changed his condition after 40-plus years, then faith in the name of Jesus today can do something for you. God's power is still available and attends to the mighty and matchless name of Jesus. Have made this man strong, whom you see and know, yea, the faith which is by him. And this faith comes by Jesus. When we say Jesus, the room is filled with heaven. When we say Jesus, the room is filled with peace. When we say Jesus, fear must go, sickness must go. Jesus' name is exalted above every name. When He is in the room, what He believes is activated. When He is in the room, what He believes is activated. And Jesus said, where two or three are gathered in my name, there am I in the midst of them. By the faith which is by him hath given him. It's a free gift. It's given to him freely. This man didn't do anything. He didn't earn it. He didn't learn it. He didn't have time to be taught. He didn't even go to healing school. He received it because it was freely given. Isn't that marvelous? That God doesn't set a man down and say, if you'll just go ahead and go to healing school for 16 weeks, you know, I'll heal you. No, the healing's already offered. Healing school will help you learn how to walk in what you have. Healing school will help you learn how to live in health and strength. That's very important. I suggest everybody go to healing school sometime and on a regular basis in the year, at least once a year. It's important. But God gave this man, and notice it's called perfect soundness. Perfect soundness. That's robust health, vitality, vibrant strength, youth being renewed in the presence of you all. And now, brethren, I know that you did it through ignorance. You did it as also did your rulers. And then to chapter 4, verse 9 through 14. Let's go there. Chapter 4, verse 9. Chapter 4, verse 9. And this is very important. Chapter 4, verse 9, if this day we be examined of the good deed. Now, stop right there. This is the good deed. Every good gift comes from above. James 1, 17. This healing that was both ministered and manifested is a good deed. Acts 10, 38, Jesus went about doing good, healing all that were oppressed of the devil. God was with him. Matthew 7, 11, if you being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more shall your Father which is in heaven give good gifts to them that ask Him? Psalms 145, 8 and 9, the Lord is gracious, full of compassion, slow to anger, and of a great, great mercy. The Lord is good to all. Now notice, put those thoughts together. This is good. Healing's good. Healing's good. Healing's good. You can add that to Romans 15, 14. You are full of goodness. Healing's good, so I'm full of healing. Healing is the children's bread. Well, you don't get the crumbs from the table. You partake of the whole loaf at the communion table. You partake of all Jesus is. It's wonderful. The Lord is good to all. Every good, perfect gift comes. Jesus went about doing good. Father, give good gift to them that ask Him. And healing's good. But 1 Thessalonians 5, 21 said, prove all things. Hold fast what's good. Because it's been given, you need to take healing and hold fast to it. Healing is yours, it belongs to you. Healing is yours, it belongs to you. Now hold it fast. If we be examined this day of the good deed done to the impotent man, by what means he is made whole. Now circle that. There he is. He's made whole. Not only has he received strength, not only has he been made whole, he is perfectly sound in the presence of the people. Wholeness comes. Be it known unto you all, unto all the people of Israel, by the name of Jesus of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him doth this man stand before you here whole. So this man was made whole. Wholeness is for us. I'm not just after healing, I'm after wholeness. This is the stone which is set at naught of the builders, which has become head of the corner. Neither is there salvation in any other. There's none other name given among heaven, given among men, whereby we must be saved. There's no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, they perceived they were unlearned and ignorant men. They marveled. They took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. And beholding the man which was healed, here's another term for this miracle, this man that was healed standing with him, they could say nothing against it. And then in verse 29 of the chapter, and now, Lord, behold their threatenings. They had been threatened to not preach or teach any more in the name. Grant your servants that with all boldness we may speak your word, but stretch ye forth your hand to heal. Do more of what you've just done, Lord. This healing's good. Stretch forth your hand to heal. Notice, grant us boldness to speak your word. When we speak the word, the hand of God begins to heal. I'm expecting you to be healed today while I speak the word. Grant me boldness to speak your word by stretching forth your hand to heal, that signs and wonders may be done by the name of thy holy child Jesus. And they prayed, and the place was shaken where they were assembled together. They were all filled with the Holy Ghost and spake the word of God with boldness. And you know that healing continued through the book of Acts. I'm so thankful when Jesus went to the heavens, took his place as our great high priest, that he gave his name and he left his ministry here. He did not take his ministry in this realm to the heavens. He left it here and he gave it to us in his name. He took up his role as the great high priest at the right hand of God and has a greater ministry there. We have a great high priest at the right hand of God. Today, Jesus is not less, he's more at the right hand of God. And because he's more, he's taken up a greater dimension, but he left us this realm with his name so we could do the same works that he did. The name of Jesus has been given for every believer to walk in, to have, to live in, to pray in, to worship in, to preach in, to teach in, to give in, love in, serve in, bless, and minister in. The name of Jesus has been given. Now, this morning, if we go back and look at physical healing in the name of Jesus, we started in Acts chapter 3. You see a great deal of maturity there. They went up. There's an increase in dimension. They went up together. There's fellowship. There's no discord, no fighting, no arguing. Peter and John are together. They went up. And then they went up into the temple at the ninth hour to pray. They entered into something, the dimension of God in the house of the Lord. The ninth hour is the hour of prayer. Jesus was forsaken at the ninth hour so that we would never be forsaken in prayer. He was not heard so that we would be heard. He was not heard so that we could be heard. And we have confidence if he hear us, then we know. 1 John 5:14 and 15. So they entered in. They were in a favored place, beautiful place, the beautiful gate. And then they had freedom, for it was open. And the gate's open today. Nothing's locked. Everything's made available and accessible to us. The gate is not locked. The gate's open today. Praise God. Everything flows freely. It's all been given freely. It is open. Healing is flowing like a river, and we are the redeemed of the Lord and blessed. So it's flowing. But yet there's frustration. There's a man here who can't walk in anything that he sees, anything that he hears, anything that is before him or open to him. He cannot walk in it. Now, God wants you to walk in things. Now, in this country, back in the late 40s, God worked a mighty work called the Healing Revival. If you'll study church history, you'll find out in the late 40s, beginning about 1948 till about 1962, God raised up specific men. There was actually a group of men from Tulsa, Oklahoma, where they were headquartered, called Healing Evangelists. I knew two of those men personally, Dr. E.L. Terry, Dr. T.L. Lowry, and talked with them about the stories. Oral Roberts, Jack Coe, There were many, many. William Branham. There were many great names of history that were there at the time of the forming of the Healing Evangelists. And across this nation, for many years, for at least 10 years, God sent men with tents around this nation, and God poured out not only Pentecost, but He poured out divine healing, signs, wonders, and miracles. And at that time, coming out of World War II and the transition this country was making, many of the people needed healing, help, and strength, and God was gracious to show healing and signs and wonders. It's recorded in Catherine Kuhlman's meeting by a testimony of a famous leader today in the body of Christ. He went to make fun of her because he was taught that women preachers were not of God, and she wore jewelry and makeup, and he was taught that that was a Jezebel spirit. So this particular man, as a child, he was infirmed in his body, and he went to make fun of her. And he sat in the balcony, and during a service, while this man testifies, now he's much older and he's a leader in the body of Christ, he said, Catherine Kuhlman stopped, looked to the balcony, pointed where I was, and she said, young man, you've come to make fun of me because you don't believe in women preachers, and that's okay, but the Lord's healing you right now in Jesus' name. And she called out his condition by the word of wisdom and word of knowledge, and the Lord healed him instantly. Now, when you go to church to make fun of somebody and the Lord heals you, what do you call that? Mercy and grace. Of all the people I would have picked that wouldn't receive their healing in that service, it would have been him, by his own testimony. But the condition in my body immediately dried up, and I was immediately healed. So God did that, and he got the attention. Whenever God does something powerful, supernatural like that, it's like throwing gold dust in the air. He's getting your attention. But the whole purpose of that, now here's what happened. That waned. You no longer have that going on in America, and this is what people cry. Where are the signs? Where are the wonders? Where are the miracles? Now, here's the thing you've got to understand about God. When he does something supernatural like that over a period of time like that, what he's telling you is, this is available, but what I want is a people who walk in it. I don't want you in a place where you always get sick and come back and need another miracle because another man has laid hands on you. I want you to learn to walk in healing. I want you to learn to walk in health. Be better, never need healing. To just live in it and walk in it. Never. The need of something is only the absence of it. If you have need of finance, you have the absence. So you don't need money when you got a bank full of money. You don't need health when you have fullness of health. Now just think, God did that so that a people would walk in that. God wants you to walk in health and strength. This is for every day. It's yours, it belongs to you, and it belongs to us. So there's a beautiful gate. It's open. We're learning to walk in it and to minister in it. And so people are crying for that. I'm longing for the day when the body of Christ receives by His stripes we're healed. That becomes our anthem and we just live well. I'm not longing for tents to come back or great miracle signs and wonders to come back. Much greater for me would be people that have lived 5, 10, 15, 20 years without a symptom or a sign of any disease and just giving God the glory, saying, God keeps me well. The Spirit within me is keeping me well. See, that's what God had ordained. And so the church missed on that. And of course, the church continues in its sickness. And then you can go to the great charismatic renewal. Same thing. He poured out His Spirit among nominal people that didn't even know if they believed in it or not. Why? He wanted them to walk in it. The same thing with the Word of Faith movement. He raised up the Word and put it back to prominence because He wants you to walk in the Word. See, it's not the movement that He was after. That was to get your attention shifted that way so He could teach you to walk in these things. God wants you to walk in these things. I'm praying God do a sign, wonder, and miracle in your feet that you walk in the Spirit. That you walk in healing, you walk in life, you walk in strength, you walk in favor, you walk in prosperity. Something's manifested in your feet. The head, Jesus, cannot say to the feet, you, I have no need of you. The head needs to be manifested in the feet. If we go to the tomb where Jesus' body lay after He was risen, there was an angel, a messenger at the head. The headship of Jesus must be preached. Jesus is Lord. He's Lord over sin. He's Lord over fear. He's Lord over sickness and disease. Jesus is Lord over all. But there's also an angel at the feet. And the angel of the feet sounds another trumpet, and that trumpet sounds, and the message is what's in the head must be manifested in the feet. That there must be a people who walk in these things. So we're walking in these things. And then we notice the mercy and focus on the needs of broken humanity, because Peter fastened his eyes on the man's need. We must never look past people who have need. Never look past people who have needs. I try very desperately not to do that. Open myself to that. Give to bless, to minister. And when you walk by people, have compassion on them. If nothing else, you see somebody in a wheelchair, pray for them. Even if you don't have the courage or conviction yet to go to them and minister to them, at least pray for them. There are people that are infirm, that are hurting. As Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me to minister to the beggar, the blind, the broken, the bound, and the bruised. Luke chapter 4:18. The blind, the beggar, the broken, the bound, and the bruised. Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me to preach deliverance to the captives, recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, the gospel to the poor. The Spirit of God is upon me to minister to the blind, the beggar, the bound, the broken, and the bruised. And if we'll go to Acts chapter 10, we'd find that when Peter was concerned about who he could minister to and who the gospel was for, God took the sheet off of his bed. God rest. God took the bed sheet, and it was four corners because God covered the earth with that sheet that he showed Peter, and he let it down before Peter, and it was white, speaking of righteousness, and in that were both clean and unclean. But yet God had cleansed and God had made right, and so he told Peter, rise, kill, and eat. And God had compassion on those that even weren't saved yet, showing Peter there the ministry of reconciliation, that we must go tell them that God has already forgiven them their sins. All he's waiting on is them to accept Jesus. God has already forgiven the world. He's already reconciled the world. God so loved the world he gave. That's already been done. We go tell them that God has forgiven them. The only thing that stands between any man and God is Jesus. And you accept Jesus, then thank God all heaven is and all heaven has becomes yours when you accept Jesus. So we learn to have mercy and compassion, learning to see people. And there are some people that are broken and you can't necessarily see it. There's some that are blind, but yet they have eyes. There are some that are broken in heart and you can't discern outwardly, and they may put on facade and appearance, but people need ministry. People need help. There are hurting, broken, crying, dying race that we're around every day called the race of humanity. Humanity's a failure everywhere. People struggle everywhere and they need what you have. You're agents of change. You're prophetic ministers of the gospel. You carry a treasure. You carry a gift. You carry an anointing. You carry the name of Jesus. You carry the authority of God in you. And when you speak and you minister, and these signs shall follow them that believe, they shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. That's your hands, beloved. Holy hands, healing hands, helping hands. That belongs to you. And so we minister in the name of Jesus to the needs of people. And people are hurting. They're broken. They need help. Well, thank God. I want to be the one that helps, don't you? I want to be the one that gives and blesses. I want to be the one that prays for the sick. I want my strength and health to minister. Let it all be unto God's glory and for His glory. Then the manifestation came in full. Now I want you to notice the progression here that we read in Acts chapter 3, verse 7. The man received strength. So every one of you need to be strengthened today. Receive strength. God strengthened you with all might in the inward man. God strengthened you with all might in the inward man. That's in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 16. And then you're to be strengthened with all might according to His glorious power in Colossians chapter 1, verse 10, 11, and 12. You're to be strengthened. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, and the Lord will strengthen you, establish you, and settle you, and ground you in the truth. So the man receives strength. So right now, Father, in the name of Jesus, I receive strength. From the crown of my head to the soles of my feet to the end of my fingers, I receive strength in my body, strength in my soul, strength in my spirit, divine strength. I receive both the inward and outward manifestation of your strength. Be strong in the Lord. Be strong in the Lord. Hear the word of the Lord. Be strong in the Lord. Be strong in the Lord and the power of His might. So thank you, Father, I receive strength both inwardly and outwardly. My soul strengthened today in Christ Jesus. So I'm strengthened. And then Peter says in verse 16 of chapter 3, he has perfect soundness. Now, this term in the Greek language has the definition or the unfolding of its meaning means that God has given mortality, life. He has given an energy, a strength, a life. Perfect soundness means that you're fortified and made whole, strengthened, and established. So right now, in the name of Jesus, I receive perfect soundness. Notice perfect soundness. Listen to it. James 1:17, every good and perfect gift. Perfect soundness. Where does it come from? It comes from above. It comes from above. It comes from above. So I receive perfect soundness. This morning as I was taking communion, I received perfect soundness in my body. Perfect soundness in my body. I'm made whole today. Now, whatever you may be struggling with in your body, you receive strength and you receive perfect soundness. And notice, in the presence of you all, it's something that can be witnessed, detected, seen. It's perfect soundness. Then in Acts chapter 4, verse 10, Peter said, "Before you, this man stands whole." Jesus said in John 5 to the crippled man, "Wilt thou be made whole?" So this speaks of God's healing power to make whole. Wholeness means nothing missing, nothing broken. The word peace in the Greek language is irene. It means nothing missing, nothing broken. God making whole. So not only do I receive strength inwardly and outwardly, and then thank God I have perfect soundness, but I'm made whole today. I receive wholeness today. I receive wholeness. I'm made whole. So receive it now in Jesus' name. That's yours. I receive wholeness from the crown of my head to the soles of my feet to the end of my fingers. I receive it. It's made available. I receive it. And then this man is healed. In Acts 4:14, Peter says that the man's healed. This man is healed, and they could not say anything against it. And as I was meditating this morning, you know, Luke was a medical doctor. He wrote this by the Spirit. But I can imagine what a field day Luke had as a medical doctor, watching Jesus and then traveling with Jesus and then traveling with Peter and watching Peter and then going on with Paul and keeping a chronicle of everything God did. Can you imagine a medical doctor watching this happen? A medical doctor. A man that was trained and skilled and schooled in medicine in that time, advanced in his class, very bright, brilliant man. Luke was a physician. Who did God give the greatest revelation of the virgin birth to? The man that knew it couldn't happen. Any doctor will tell you a virgin can't conceive. That's impossible. Who did God give the detailed account of the virgin birth to? A medical doctor. So he lets Luke, and if you'll read the story, I personally enjoy Luke's record of the healings of Jesus just for that reason. He's a medical doctor, and he writes some things that others don't write. For example, he says of the man that came to be healed as a leper, Luke said he was full of leprosy. When Luke saw that, he said, "That man right there, he's dead. He's full of leprosy." Well, none of the others just said he was, all the others said he was a leper. Luke said he's full of leprosy. And immediately his leprosy was cleansed. Well, Luke's writing this, and this man, soundness, perfect soundness, strength, wholeness, and he is healed. And Luke wrote that by the Spirit of God. So today, my prayer for you is, as you listen to this and you receive the word of the Lord, faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the word of God, that you receive strength, that perfect soundness is ministered and manifested in you, that you are made whole and healed in your body. That belongs to you today. There's not one feeble one among our tribes, and by whose stripes you were and are healed. That's yours today. That's yours today. I receive that in my body, and my strength is renewed in Christ Jesus. Now, if you will, I want to talk to you about this message of healing to glorify His Son, and what I want to concentrate on this morning, as the Lord dealt with me, concerning the trumpets of healing. And let's go in 1 Corinthians 15. Look there with me. 1 Corinthians 15, the trumpets of healing. And faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the word of God. There are two things that are crucial to your connection to the healing gospel. One is your ear, the other is your eye. Your ear and your eye. You know, if a doctor shines a light in your ear, it makes no difference. But if he shines a light in your eye, your eyes are affected by light. Your ears are affected by sound. So it's not only hearing, but seeing healing. Now, 1 Corinthians 15:51. "Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep." Does anybody want to shout about that? Now, that's not talking about you taking a nap. That's talking about you dying. He said, everybody in the body of Christ is not going to die. Now not everybody's going to sleep. You read that? And I'm glad I didn't write that. I'm glad he did by the Holy Ghost. "Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep." Now that's a mystery. There are going to be some, even some among us, I believe, that won't taste of death. We which are alive and remain at the coming of the Lord. "I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep." One preacher took that for his nursery scripture. Put it up in his nursery. "All the babies may not sleep, but when you get your baby back, they shall be changed." Hallelujah. I thought that was pretty creative when I saw that. Well, praise God, there's more here than a nursery scripture. Hallelujah. Some of you, what is he talking about? The babies may not all sleep, but they'll all be changed. You get your baby back here with a clean diaper, guaranteed. Praise God. "Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep or die, but we shall all be changed. Now, come on, shout with me. We shall all be changed. That means somewhere in my future, there's a change that is going to ratify the problem completely. We shall all be changed. The anthem of the healing gospel ends with your body shall be changed, and that mortality you set in shall put on immortality. What an anthem, that this that I stand in today that is mortal will put on immortality. It is decreed by the gospel. We shall all, not one left, not one lacking, you shall be changed. Praise God. We shall all be changed. What power to take even the molecular structure of the physiology of the body and change it and take sin from it, take sin out of it, and put that body in a state of righteousness where it will never grow old, never grow weak, never grow tired, never faint, and you'll live forever in that body glorified. Philippians 3:21 said, we look from Him in verse 20 for the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our vile body and give us a glorious body like His glorious body, whereby the power and working He is able to subdue all things unto Himself. There's nothing that He does not control, nothing He cannot change, and He will even restore the body and give us a body like His glorious body. And Jesus said, you handle me, a spirit hath not flesh and bone as you see me have. We shall not all sleep. That's good news. But we shall all be changed. That's even better news. And even if you went by way of the grave, praise God, you'd still be changed. We shall all be changed. Notice how it happens. In the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, this trumpet is bringing both light and sound. When we read this, there's something happening in the eye. You need to see this. Change happens by looking. 2 Corinthians 3:18, we are changed from glory to glory by beholding in a mirror the glory of the Lord. You're changed by seeing. Whatever you're looking at is opening unto you. Doesn't matter what it is, whether it's in the realm of sin and darkness and the fall or the realm of the kingdom of God. When you look at something, it opens up to you. John said, I looked and behold, the door was open. I looked and behold, the door was open. The twinkling of an eye. Listen to what Jesus said in Matthew 6. If thine eye be single, thine whole body, not your spirit or soul, but your whole body, shall be full of light. And that's what this trumpet does, is bring you to a single eye to look to Jesus, the author and finisher of your faith, your healing, and your strength, and your health. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. So we circle that. If there's going to be a last trump, then there have to be preceding trumpets. If I brought to you my children and said, this is my last child, that would tell you immediately, at least I've got one more. There's no way I can have a last unless you have a first. And there are trumpets that bring this message of healing to fruition. Notice, we should be changed at the last trump. Here's some word. Listen to it. The trumpet shall sound. This is not indefinite. It's not maybe. God, think about it. The trumpet shall sound. And last night, the Lord assured me that even the trumpet of immortality is not left completely up to God to sound. We're sounding this trumpet today of the gospel of healing that will bring us to this place where we can sound and where we can put on this quickening life by faith and be quickened in our body. Now, how far can you go in that? I don't know, but I know I hadn't gone far enough. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. The corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. And every time you sit in healing, every time you sit in the name of Jesus, every time you lay down thoughts of sickness, take on thoughts of healing, health, and strength, you're laying off corruption and putting on incorruption. And every time your body is quickened and healing comes to your physical body, you're putting on that immortality. That healing that works in your body from Romans 8:11 is the Spirit of God, and that's eternal. That is the power of God. That's the life of God. Can never die, never be sick, never lazy, never tired, never weak. That's the life of God. Romans 8:11 said, if the Spirit of Him that raised Jesus from the dead, He that raised Christ from the dead shall quicken your mortal body by His Spirit. See, that's eternal life. That's the Zoe of God, the quickening of God by His Spirit that does what? Dwells in you. So we need to hear these trumpets. Now, you can write this down, and then I'm going to preach to you this morning. Out of Jeremiah 6 and verse 16, God said to the people there in the old covenant, now stand fast and stand in the old paths, which were plural. And in the old covenant, you know, there were six paths. You remember what they were? The law and the prophets, the priesthood and the sacrifice go together, the feast and the commandments. You had six paths. Stand in the old paths. And he said, you'll see the way, walk in it. From the six, you'll see the one. Because Jesus fulfilled the law and the prophets, the priesthood and the sacrifices, and he fulfilled the feast and the commandments of the Lord. He fulfilled all that. You'll walk in it. Walk in it. Ask the good old paths and walk in them in Jeremiah 6:16. The people there said, we will not walk in them. Then, in verse 17, I set watchmen over you that said, hearken ye to the voice of the trumpet. And you said, we will not. Now, it comes to this. We must be able, according to Jeremiah 6:16 and 17, see and hear. According to 1 Corinthians 15:51 through 54, see and hear. The light affects your eye, the sound affects your ear. Faith comes by hearing, but change comes by seeing. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to sound these trumpets. Now, in case you're wondering, there are 22 trumpets, and I won't have time to sound them all. Obviously, we'd be here till tonight about 4 o'clock. It'd take too long. So we'll go as far as we can in this, but 22 is a significant number in your Bible. It's the number of priesthood. And if we go to the candlestick of Moses' tabernacle, we'll find there are 22 bowls on the branches. We'll find the bowls. There are 22. And on each branch, there were 3 bowls. The bowls held the oil, and that shows you that you're the branch of the Lord. And the oil, the Spirit of God in you, and there's a light shining. And what you had was you had 22 bowls on that candlestick. The candlestick is the church. And then from that, the Spirit of man is the candle of the Lord. So if you just get a picture of a bowl with oil in it, there are 3 on every branch. You've got oil in your spirit, you've got oil for your soul, and oil for your body. There's the Spirit of God to work in you, spirit, soul, and body. It's 1 Thessalonians 5:23. Then if you'll notice that there are 22, and it's amazing, the light shine from the bowl. There was the bud, and then there was the flower, and then the bowl on every branch. They had 3 sets of 3 ornaments, and there were 9 fruit, 9 beatitude, 9 gifts of the Spirit. He decorated every branch with himself. It's a picture. Now you have 22. 22 is the number of priesthood. And if we go deeper and we go further, you know, the word light itself is mentioned 264 times in your Bible. If you take 22 and divide it into 264, you'll find it goes in there 12 times. And 12 is the number of administration. Put it together. The administrator of the light, the Spirit of God, is to administer this light, spirit, soul, and body, in the candlestick, the church, which is you, to shine not only to you, but to a lost, hurting, dark, broken world. The light. When the trumpet sounds, the light comes. You'll see flashes of light. You begin to see, and the Lord may show you, you standing whole. You standing healed, you'll begin to see things, and then you'll begin to hear things. Hearing brings faith, sight brings change. If thine eye be single, thy body shall be full of light. Moses was 120 years old, and his eye, not his eyes, his eye was not dim. Now, if you've got eyes, they go dim, but an eye will not go dim because it looks only to the Lord. So I'm expecting my body to be full of light. Praise God, that's healing, health, and strength. Praise God. Full of light. That's healing. The entrance of His Word gives light. It gives understanding to the simple. So I'm healed in my body. I'm strengthened today. I'm blessed today. Praise God. And I'm made whole. And remember, the full manifestation of this is strength, perfect soundness, wholeness, and healing. All belongs to us. It's all paid for by Jesus. And it's yours. And the Spirit of God wants to minister to you. So you have it so you can walk out of here with it today and walk in it the rest of your days. Paid for by Jesus, by His stripes. All right, let's sound these trumpets. Remember, He said, I've given you watchmen to sound the trumpet. My word to you this morning, hearken ye to the voice of the trumpet. The trumpet is the voice of the Lord. Trumpet number one, God Almighty never changes. All He ever was, He is. All He ever did, He does. He does not change. I am the Lord your God. I change not. Malachi 3:6. Before Abraham was, Jesus said, I am. Jesus said, I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. I am the light of the world. I am the door. I am the bread. I am the good shepherd. Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever. And God told Moses, I am that I am. David said, from everlasting to everlasting, thou art the same. Thou changest not, and thy throne, O God, is forever. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 8, and from the Psalms. God never changes. So here's some good news. If he was a healer, then thank God he is a healer. Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Nissi, Jehovah Tsidkenu, Jehovah Shammah, Jehovah Rael, Jehovah Shalom, Jehovah Rapha, El Shaddai, El Elyon, your God does not change. James 1:17, neither variableness, neither shadow of turning with him. He is forever. He is Almighty God, all by himself. He's the eternal God, the immortal God. He hath life. He is life. He is Lord, sovereign, reigning, ruling. He's the Almighty, the all-sufficient God, and all he ever was, he is, and he will not change. And it's strange to me how in church we come up with this theology. You never know what God's going to do, when yet he never changes. It's amazing to me how we come up with theology that says God works in mysterious ways his wonders to perform, when he's the most consistent one among us all. When you can look at somebody in your life and you can say this about somebody, I guarantee you, I know what he's going to do. When you tell him that, I know exactly what he's going to say. And some of you would be right. Because you've watched people enough to know how consistent some of them can be, even in bad behavior. You tell him that, he's going to blow up sure as the world. And he'll do it. And you know it. But then you turn around and look at God and say, you never know what he's going to do. You just never know what he's going to do. No, I don't have any idea. I do. He's going to do what he said. And the mystery's taken out of it when you realize he always does what he said. But when you operate outside the word, then you never know. People come up to be prayed for. What are you standing on? I don't know. What scripture? What promise? I don't know. What am I going to get? I don't know. See, he's specific. Let me give you a real powerful revelation. You'll never be dynamic in anything till you're specific. You never will be. You'll never be dynamic in anything until you're specific in it. If you wanted to be a marksman with a bow, if you don't have a target, then you could just shoot the arrow any which way and it matters not, because you'll never ever be dynamic. But a marksman that could take a bow and from 50 yards put it through the bullseye takes somebody that's specific. You have to be specific. Shoot the bow, aim at the target, draw the sight, pull it back, let it go with steady hand. It takes a dynamic, comes out of a specific. God never changes, and you'll never be dynamic in faith. And do you realize God doesn't change? He's not going to change his mind for you or for me or for us or anybody else. His word is forever. It is settled in the heavens. It does not lie. It cannot change. It's his word. And he has said, by whose stripes you're healed. He will not change. And the glory and wonder of this word is, no matter when you open it up, night or day, no matter what's going on in your life, it says the same thing. It never changes. So you know what to believe. And he says, by whose stripes you're healed. He's not going to change his mind. He's not going to change his thought. He says, by whose stripes you're healed. Now I'm wondering what you say. Isn't that marvelous? God never changes. What a trumpet today. God never changes. He's my provider and he'll never stop providing. He's my righteousness and he'll never stop being my righteousness. He's my strength and he'll never stop being my strength. He's my anointing. He'll never stop being my anointing. He is my strength. He is my sufficiency. He is glory. He is power, and he does not change. He's Almighty God, all by himself, anytime, all the time. God anywhere, God everywhere. He's Almighty God, and that's all he can be. He's the Almighty God, and he's your God. Let's go further. He is your Father. God never changes. And that trumpet needs to sound and the people get confidence in the character of God that he doesn't change. That God is omniscient, knows everything. That God is omnipresent. He is everywhere. And he is omnipotent, has all power. But he never changed. The Lord is good. He never changed. He's merciful. He never changes. His mercies are new every morning. He's a good God. He's a good Father. He loves broken humanity. He loves his children. And he's not going to change for you or me or anybody else. I've had some marvelous ideas that I took to the Lord. I have tried desperately to persuade him to agree with me, but he never does. So I quit. I did that a long time. I quit. Now I say, what's the idea? What's the plan? What's the idea? What's the thought? Because I know that one of us needs to change and one of us is going to have to change, and it's not going to be him. He's not going to change for you. He won't change for preachers or religion or denominations, or no matter what men say about him, he will not change. He's the same. Trumpet number one sounds. Trumpet number two sounds. The creation of man. God made a man in his own image. And I love this. I love to preach this. God never made a human being. That is the best news I could trumpet to you today. He never made a human being. Humanity was not God's idea. Because you hear this all the time in church. Now, we're only human. We're only human. And that's not true of you because you're born again. You're born from above. You're not human. You're a new creation in Christ. You're a recreated, born again spirit. You've been made right with God through the Lord Jesus Christ. You're sons and daughters of God. See, you're birthed out of Him. Do you believe that? Now, you're still dealing with your humanity, but in your spirit, you are born again. You're a new creature in Christ. Christ, you're redeemed and you're made free. Praise God. So here God sits majestically, and remember now this host of angels that are with him, they've never seen him do anything but sit and speak. That's all they know. He sits and he says, all right, on the first day, light be, and light is. And on the second day, let the earth and the waters gather into one place, and they do. And let the earth on the third day bring forth. And on the fourth day, he sits from a throne, sun, moon, stars, and the millions and trillions of stars, his word, and there they were. What was just a dark canvas is now lit up with glittering stars for millions and trillions of miles. Just a word. That's all these angels know. On the fifth day, he said, let the earth bring forth and the cattle of the beast of the field and the waters from the sea. Let the whale and the fish be brought forth and the cattle in the field and the fowl in the air. And he spoke into the atmosphere and he created from the atmosphere. And that's all they know is a God who sits and speaks. That's all they know. So on the sixth day of creation, they're all watching, and he gets up from his throne. They've never seen it. They've never seen this. What's he doing? I have no idea. Gabriel, you're closer to us than anybody else. You're closer to him. What's he doing? I've never seen him do this. He's going to that little blue ball called Earth. Why is he going there? And he comes to a garden, and he bows down. They've never seen him bow. But the word bless means to bow. He blessed the man. He bowed. That means he got on his knees. He bowed. He blessed. And with his hands, see, God put his hands on man and nothing else. That's why everybody has a longing to be touched by God, because he put it there in the beginning. See, God's very particular about what he puts his hands on. And he forms man from the dust of the earth. Genesis 2:7. Now just think, God working with his hands, and they're all around looking in amazement, the angelic host, and they're peering in, and God bows, and he forms the eye, the retina, and the cornea, and the lens, and the ear, the hammer, the anvil, and the stirrup, and he connects, and then he puts the ear in place, and he forms the eye sockets, and then he fixes the nose, and he forms the mouth, and makes the tongue, and then he comes into the spine, and he takes the central nervous system, and he puts that together with his hands, and he makes the brain, and he fixes it to function, and he creates all the parts of the brain. He puts the medulla. He puts all of the parts of the brain. He fixes it and he sets everything just right. He makes hands and feet and legs and joints. And then he forms a heart and lungs and a pancreas. And he fixes a stomach and a small intestine, a large intestine. And he's doing it. He's doing it with his hands. Can you imagine the complexity of what you are? One man told me, I don't believe in miracles. I said, well, I do. He said, why do you believe in miracles? I said, because I've seen you. If there weren't miracles, you couldn't think. If there weren't miracles, you couldn't walk, talk, speak. When you stand up, that's a miracle. Your spine, your central nervous system, your brain. And if you think all that come out of an explosion, if you think that came out of a big bang, I promise you, explosions don't create order. And you are fearfully and wonderfully made. Your heart beating in your chest, your bloodstream, your blood pressure, you have cognizant thought, your body sleeps, your body knows how to digest food, your body is a miracle. Stand up, sit down, walk. If you woke up in your right mind, you are a living, breathing miracle. All you gotta do is just see a baby born and you'll see the miracle. You cannot help it if you see a baby born. Unbelievable. Just above and beyond. And from the womb came a baby, and that baby is formed and fashioned, and the baby cries and totally helpless yet. But God did that. But yet, lifeless, and God stands it up after working meticulously. Now remember, when He's sitting on His throne, He speaks one word and those stars are there. He speaks one word and the sun is in its place and it's going to shine till He tells it to do something else. It's pretty impressive. Our sun, several thousand Earths would fit in our sun. They recently discovered a star that over 7,000 of our suns would fit in that one star, and He just said it and it was there. You're dealing with an amazing God today. And He looks at His angels, He looks at Gabriel, and Gabriel says, "Sir, I must admit, I'm not impressed. It doesn't look like your best work to me." And God smiles and said, "I haven't put my mouth on it yet. Just watch." God takes a deep breath, and celestial glory begins to surround Him, and He puts His mouth on the mouth of that mannequin, and life is breathed into that man. And the man became a living soul. And the man walked like God, talked like God, had dominion in the earth as God had dominion in the universe. And the angels in awe said, "God has now revealed Himself in a man in the earth, for man was made in God's image." Now here's why that's so important to the healing gospel, is because that man was not a human. He was a man, standing spirit, soul, and body complete. He was not missing, not lacking anything. He was filled with health, and that body was designed to rejuvenate itself. And in the garden, in the truth, He could have lived on perpetually without death, disease, dying, or decay. God made a man in His image. And here's why He did it. Because that's what He wanted. If He would have wanted a blind, broken, diseased, dying human, He would have made that. But He made a man in His own image, standing in His glory, standing in His likeness, with a word in His mouth that would govern the nations of the earth. He made a man in His own image, not a human. And Adam did not have scoliosis, blinded eyes. He did not have kidney failure. He did not have stomach upset. He did not have asthma in his lungs or allergies in his nostrils. He did not. He was whole and strong. Why did God make a man that way? It's because that's what He wanted. You take any great painter from days gone by, you take Van Gogh or you take Leonardo da Vinci, it matters not, put a blank canvas in front of them and said, "I'll come back in a year, and whatever's in your heart, whatever you desire, whatever you want on that canvas, you put it there with no restraint and no restriction." That's what God did. He could have made anything He wanted in a man. He could have made anything, but I look at what He made. He made a man in His own image. Are you ready? Now, this is weighty, what I'm about to say to you. If God had wanted man to be full of disease, death, dying, and decaying, He would have made him that way. But He didn't, because that's not what He wanted. Thank you. That's amazing that God made a man in His own image. Hallelujah. It's amazing. What a revelation that God did not make a man full of disease. Why? It's not what He wanted. Can you prove it? Well, sure, let's go on into eternity. Who will you find a million years from now in the kingdom of God? Who will be diseased there? Who will be diseased, dying, and decaying? No one. No one. No one. No one. That's very important to the healing gospel. Third trumpet sounds. Man's disobedience introduced sin to the human family. And with sin came dying, death, disease, and decay. With sin came dying, death, disease, and decay. It was not here before Adam sinned. Romans 5:12, by one man, not by one God, not by one devil, but by one man, sin entered the world and death passed upon all men. God told Adam, "In the day you eat this, you shall," what's it say? "You shall surely die." The moment he partook of that, spirit died, cut off from God, soul began to go dark, but the body remained. He lived. He didn't just drop over dead. But here's what we missed. A day with the Lord is 1,000 years. And Adam, from the moment that he ate that, that's where time was introduced. You see, in the Garden of Eden was the seventh day. There's no beginning, no ending to it. Genesis chapter 2, 1 through 4. When you read the first 6 days, they have an even and morning. When you get to the seventh day, there is no even, there is no morning, because it's beyond time. He lived in the realm of spirit. He was a man living in the spirit. What are we? Men and women living in the spirit. He was beyond the realm of time. When he fell, time began. And from the moment he fell until he died, do you know how long Adam lived? 930 years. You know who was the oldest in your Bible? His name was Methuselah. He lived to be 969 years, and a day with the Lord's 1,000 years. God's always right in the day you do this. Adam didn't quite live one day. He died at 930 years old. Disease came through the fall. Death, decay, dying, and disease came through the fall. So the answer and the remedy to the fall is what Jesus did on the cross. There's only one answer for Adam's transgression. There's only one answer for Adam's sin. No matter what consequence may befall broken humanity, there's only one remedy for the fall, and that's what Jesus did. Trumpet number 4 sounds. The curse contains sickness and disease in it. God did not call sickness and disease a blessing. He called it a curse. Deuteronomy 28, there are 11 specific diseases mentioned. And then in 28:61, he just simply said, "Also, the Lord God will bring upon you every sickness and disease that is not written in the book of the law, and every plague, until thou be destroyed and consumed off the land." God putting sickness on me is under the curse of the law, and every sickness and disease not even written in the book is under the curse of the law. Now that's good news. God calls sickness a curse. Job 37:23. We don't quote it much. The Almighty is plenteous in justice and mercy. He will not afflict. Job 37:23. He will not afflict. Praise God. That's good news. Sickness is under the curse of the law. God is merciful. Trumpet number 5 sounds. And now there's healing in the Old Testament. God rejuvenated the body of Abram, and healing began. Healing begins to flow. And the first record you have of healing is in Genesis 20, where Abram prayed, and God healed Abimelech, his wife, and his maidservants, and they did bear children. And healing began to flow, and that old covenant people had access to healing. Hezekiah kept the Passover, and the people were healed in their body. There was not one feeble one among them when they were brought out. God promised Jeremiah, my favorite Old Testament healing scripture, Jeremiah 30, verse 17, "I will restore health unto thee, saith the Lord, and heal thee of thy wounds." I receive that, Lord. I receive that, Lord. Last chapter of the Old Covenant, Malachi 4:2, "Unto you that fear my name," Lord, we fear your name today, "shall the Son of Righteousness arise with healing in his wings." And those wings are the method of ascent. The method of ascent was the power of the resurrection. And through the power of the resurrection, there's healing flowing today all the way through the Old Covenant. And those Old Covenant saints had access to healing, health, and strength. But we have a better covenant established on better promises. If David would write in the Old Covenant and say, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless His holy name. Forget not all His benefits," under the Old Covenant. "Who forgiveth all mine iniquities, who healeth all my diseases, who redeems my life from destruction, crowns me with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies my mouth with good things, so my youth is renewed like the eagle." If David had a revelation in the Old Covenant of a God who healed all his diseases, we have a better covenant, Hebrews 8:6, established on better promises, praise God. We're far better off in every dimension today. Healing fills that old covenant. Now, some people believe healing was just for the Jews. If that were true, when you get sick, you'd be better off being a Jew than you would be a believer. You know that's not true. It couldn't be true. In every dimension, the covenant that we have is far superior to the old covenant. The sixth trumpet sounds, and here comes Jesus over the horizon. And John says, "Behold, the Lamb of God taketh away the sin of the world." He goes into Jordan. He's baptized of John. He goes into the wilderness 40 days to be tempted of the devil. He passes the test of the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. He came back in the power of the Spirit. And you'll find in Matthew 4, 23 and 24. You'll find in Matthew 8, 1 through 17. You'll find in Matthew chapter 9. You'll find in Matthew chapter 10. You'll find in Matthew chapter 15. You'll find in Luke chapter 4. You'll find in Luke chapter 5. You'll find in Luke 5, 15 and Luke 6, 17. They came to hear Him and be healed of their diseases. Jesus came and He was a living, breathing revelation in every Everywhere Jesus went, diseases left people's body. Jesus was a healer. And Jesus was and is the living will of God in action. Jesus said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. That tells me in no uncertain terms, the Father is a healer. For Jesus went about doing good, healing all that were oppressed of the devil. God was with him. Jesus healed blind Bartimaeus, the woman with the issue of blood. He cleansed the leper. He discharged the debtor. He raised the dead. He cleansed. He healed. He forgave. He strengthened. He blessed. He raised up humanity. He lifted the woman with the spirit of infirmity. Jesus was a healer. And He's the same. And beloved, today He's not less at the right hand of majesty on high. He's more today. Praise God, He's multiplied in a people. The healing power of Jesus to heal you and make you every whit whole is in this house, because Jesus is in this house. And that same power is in you, for Jesus Himself, the heavenly healer, lives in you. By whose stripes you're healed. By whose stripes you're healed. The trumpet sound. Hearken to the voice of the trumpet. That old covenant people said, we will not hearken to the voice of the trumpet today. God never changes. He made a man without disease. Disease came through the fall. Sickness is under the curse. God provided healing from the curse in the Old Testament. Jesus came to deliver, heal, and save broken humanity. But then we come to the stripes of the Lord Jesus. And Jesus, before being crucified, went to what is called the Roman whipping post. It was cruel. It was agonizing. It was torturous. Professional whipmasters. That's what these men did for a living. They beat people to death. That was their job. They were trained assassins. They were trained professionals. They had tools of the trade. They were skilled with what they did. This was not their first scourging. They had done many. Jesus was a Jew. The Romans hated the Jews. So He already had the hatred of the Romans who were about to whip Him. Number two, He stood silent and would not open His mouth. They wanted to beat a confession out of Him of His guilt or His innocence, but He would not open His mouth, only to infuriate them. Isaiah records, as a sheep is dumb before the shearer, so He openeth not His mouth. That infuriated them. And as they beat Him and cut Him with their whips and their torturous instruments, lancing blow after lancing blow on the back. Now, 1 Peter 2:24 said, by whose stripes you were healed. Greek word for stripes is the Greek word malapia. It is singular. So if we translate that strictly from Greek, we would say, then by the stripe of Jesus we were healed. If we go deeper into the etymology of the word, by the wound of Jesus. So when they got through with Jesus, His back from the nape of His neck to the base of His spine was one gaping wound, and the flesh was torn from it. The psalmist would record, they furrowed my back. Isaiah would record in Isaiah 50 and verse 6, Jesus said, I gave my back. I gave my back. And who did He give it to? The most unworthy, the most ungodly and holy people on the planet that day were those who would crucify Jesus. Who did He give His back to? He gave His back not to His children. He gave His back not to His friends, not to His disciples or apostles, but to the smiters. That's incredible. He gave His back to the smiters. And they spent their time. And the first 39 lashes went on Jesus' back to ratify the old covenant. That's why there were 39. That's why the Jewish law was 39 stripes. But He was not scourged by Jews. The Romans had no such law, and their intent was to beat a man to death there, and probably were given bonus and extra money and extra pay for doing their job well. And they beat at their pleasure. They beat one and then another. They took turns until Jesus' back had been completely lacerated. There was one wound, and Jesus took stripes there for your healing. Matthew 8, 17, Himself took our infirmities and bare our sickness and carried our diseases. Jesus took stripes. Now, the stripes of Jesus were there to pay the healing price for sickness, disease, and all decay of the body. And Jesus on the cross had no healing. Jesus on the cross had no healing, had no help. And when he died, his body was completely in state as it had died. They brought him down, wrapped his body, and put it in the tomb. For of the holy days they came on Sunday morning, you're reading your Bible, with the spices to anoint him for burial. Because of the holy days, they didn't even get to do that. Died on Wednesday afternoon. They were coming early Sunday morning at the beginning of the week to anoint his body and to prepare his body. Now think with me. Jesus died, and the stripes of Jesus are all inclusive to our healing. For both Isaiah and Peter said, by whose stripes? But yet when Jesus died, there's no healing. Jesus on the death side paid for sickness. Jesus on the death side suffered what we were. Jesus on the death side bled and shed blood. And we thank God for the shedding of his blood. And we thank God for the sufferings of Jesus and the sufferings of Messiah and what he bore and what he endured and what he took. Jesus took that, but no healing came to Jesus. Isaiah would say, with his stripes, you are healed. But it's not over. They laid him in a tomb, but it's not over. It's not over. Jesus said, you crucify me. 3 days I'll raise this body up. I'll raise this temple up. So on the third day, Jesus got up from the dead. I wish you'd preach with me 5 more minutes. I'll be done. Come on. Don't just hear that. Come on. Let it get in. Jesus got up from the dead. He died to make men holy, but he lives. Jesus rose from the dead. He lives to make men free. I listened to a testimony of a man the other day that was involved in raising a man from the dead. Marvelous testimony to the name of Jesus. But my heart sank as I thought, how the church rejoices around a man being raised from the dead who will only die again, who only will go back to the grave if he would go on and not walk in immortality. He'll die again. But Jesus got up, and here's some shouting ground. He's never going back. He conquered death. He conquered hell. He conquered the grave. He put it away. Jesus is Lord in the dark domain. He reigns forever. He's Lord over death and hell. He'll never be touched by death again. He lives forever. Hallelujah. He lives forever. And when that body, according to the psalmist, all my bones are out of joint, when that physical body was laying in that tomb, every bone out of joint, every drop of blood drained from it, and we look to his back, it is one bloody mess. But God's power came in that tomb, and from the crown of his head to the soles of his feet, as God breathed life back into him, his spirit and soul came back into that body, then God raised him up, and he got up in a body that will never die again. He says, handle me, a spirit hath not flesh and bone as you see me have. There's no blood in that body today, for the blood rests on the mercy seat, but in his veins flows the glory of God. Jesus is alive forever. I am he that liveth and was dead. I am alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and the keys of hell, saith the Lord. And when Jesus got up, that body was restored, taken from corruption to incorruption, taken from sickness, death to glorified. And because God did that in his body, you're an heir of God and a joint heir with Christ, and that gave God the legal right to do that in your body. And until he does it completely, it gives him the right to put the healing power that healed his back into your body and make you well and drive disease out of your body, by whose stripes you were healed today. Stand with me in Jesus' name. That's long enough. If you aren't got it, you ain't going to get it by now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's alive. Come on, shout with me this morning. He lives. He died to make men holy, but he lives to make men free. He lives to make men free. He lives to make men free. Jesus of Nazareth, the Son of the living God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I promise you, Jesus did not come out of that tomb with a backache. He did not come out of that tomb with a back that was not healed. He did not come out of that tomb. So then the death side pays for sickness, but the life side with his stripes. When were his stripes healed? When he died or when he rose from the dead? No, listen to it again. If the spirit of him that raised Jesus from the dead dwell in you, The Spirit that raised Him from the dead dwell in you. He that raised Christ from the dead shall quicken. That's the quickening right there. What happened in His body is now to be happening in your body in Jesus' name. Praise God. Praise God. We're blessed today. Thank you, Lord. I receive strength today. Hallelujah. I receive this perfect soundness in the presence of you all. Hallelujah. I receive wholeness and healing in the presence of the saints. Thank you, Father. I receive today. Thank you. I'm made strong. Thank you. Perfect soundness comes. Thank you in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. The trumpet of the resurrection sounds, and then the trumpet of the exaltation. Jesus has been exalted. Ephesians chapter 1 says, "What is the exceeding greatness of His power to us who believe, according to the working of His mighty power, which He wrought in Christ when He raised Him from the dead, set Him at His own right hand, far above all principality and power, might and dominion." And here's your healing. "And every name that is named in this world or in the world to come." Every disease has a name. And in Ephesians chapter 1, Jesus was raised above every name, whether it's in this world or the world to come, and put all things under His feet. There's your healing right there. They discover a new type of cancer. They call it brain cancer. They call it breast cancer. They call it stomach cancer. They call it bone cancer. They call it leukemia. Doesn't matter. As soon as they discover a disease, they call it AIDS. They call it polio. They call it blindness. They call it liver failure. They've got names for every disease. But thank God, He's been raised above every name, not only in this world, but even if there's names to come in the world to come, it matters not. We rest assured. He's champion here. He's champion there. He's Lord here. He's Lord there. He's King here. He's King there. He's mighty here. He's mighty there. He's unchallenged here. He's unchallenged there. He's glorified here. He's glorified there. Jesus has been exalted over every disease known to man and every disease unknown to man. He's been exalted over them all. And Jesus lives to heal the hurting and the broken. Jesus. See, there's healing in His name. Through faith in His name. Through faith in His name. My faith is in the name of Jesus. Does this man have this perfect soundness in the presence of you all? Last scripture this morning, James 5:16. Confess your faults one to another. The word "faults" literally means any place you've strayed. It's not the Greek word hermeneia, which means sin, but it doesn't mean any place you strayed. So if you strayed from the healing gospel, if you strayed from it, if you've been talking your sickness, if you've strayed from it, it's easy to do. He said you need to confess your faults one to another. There have been some places where we just miss it from time to time. It's okay. We need one another. Confess your faults one to another. But look at this. Pray one for another, that you may be healed. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man, which is the head and body, the body of Jesus Christ. We're righteous. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man does what? It avails much. Pray one for another that you may be healed. Now, if you need to receive healing in your body, come stand with me this morning in front of the building. Come stand. If you need to receive healing, come stand. Come stand with me. If you need to receive healing in your body. Come stand with me. If you need to receive healing, come stand with me. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Now, all of you that came forward, I want you to pair up. We're going to pray one for another. Teresa, you go with Miss Dolores. You too. Find somebody to pray with. Find a partner. Find a partner. We have somebody for Miss Dream over here. A lady with Miss Dream. Let's put Ben with men. Cheryl, come on over. You come on. There you go. All right. Sam, you going to pray with him? All right. Sammy, you need somebody? Pray with you. You take Mr. Wayne. Fred, you and Jim work together. That'll be good. All right? And you ladies agree with me, okay? Praise God. Aren't you glad you're well today? You didn't need to come up here. Aren't you glad? Health and strength. Praise God. All right? Richard, you agree with me. Now, we're going to do what Scripture said. I want you to pray for that person that they be healed in their body. Just pray. Pray one for another. Right now, Lord, you told me to do what you said, so pray one for another that we may be healed. We agree right now in the name of Jesus that healing fills this room and healing fills our body. And I thank you. The same power that raised Jesus from the dead heals our body and strengthens us now. I thank you. Miss Bev Carnes is healed in her body. She receives a new heart today. I thank you, Lord. I ask you for that this morning, her healing. I thank you. Teresa and Dolores are healed. I thank you, Lord. Marnes and Maggie are healed. Dream and Sherl are healed. Lord, I thank you. I praise you and I bless you and I thank you. Healing fills and strengthens. Healing blesses. Healing Sammy today. Lord, that you may be healed. This is an effectual prayer. It's fervent and it avails much. For we stand in your righteousness. Pray from your righteousness. By whose stripes you were healed. We proclaim over this congregation by whose stripes we're healed. And right now, healing flows. Healing flows. It manifests right now, Lord, strength, perfect soundness, wholeness, and healing manifest in our physical body. All of us, Lord, for myself and Richard, for Jim and Fred, for Mr. Wayne and Mr. Sammy, Lord, for Richard and myself, Lord, thank you and praise you and bless you. In Jesus' name, healing flows. For by whose stripes you and with whose stripes you are healed, were healed. Thank you for healing. 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 Thank you, Father. In advance, we thank you for healing. Thank you, Jesus. That's it. Just pray one for another. As you feel led, led by the Spirit, as you feel led. Don't pray for yourself. Pray for somebody else right now. Lord, my brothers, my sisters need healing. They're healed in their body. Lord, thank you. Hearts beat right. Blood pressure comes down. Stomach issues disappear. Joint pain leaves. Back pain leaves. Healing flows. We decree healing in this church. We decree healing in the name of Jesus. For by whose stripes you were healed. By whose stripes you were healed. By whose stripes. Father, thank you. By whose stripes, by whose stripes, by whose stripes, by whose stripes, by whose stripes you were healed. Thank you that healing flows. Thank you that healing flows. Thank you that healing flows. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, let healing flow. Let healing flow. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. That's it. Now that you've received it, start thanking Him for your healing. Start thanking Him for your healing. Start thanking the Lord for your healing. Lord, I receive strength today, perfect soundness, wholeness, and healing in my body. Thank you, Lord. And I pronounce over you that you'll come to your grave in a full old age like a shock of corn in the field. Job 5:26. David died in a good old age, full of riches, honor, and day. God's promised us long life. But yet for some of us, we shall not all sleep. Hallelujah. Even death itself is under the feet of Jesus. We which are alive and remain at the coming of the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Glorious virtue. Powerful healing. Minister healing to us, Jesus. Heal your people, Jesus. And I thank you for it. And I thank you for it. And I thank you for it. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. 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 Thank you that you're healing. Healing's manifest. Now I pray over you and all of you now in the name of Jesus. As we're closing, I pray over you that God's doing a supernatural work in your feet. You're going to walk in these things. These things you've heard today, you're going to walk in these things. It's not just a healing service till the next healing service. You're going to walk in some amazing health, some redounding health and strength, some remarkable change in your physical body. Remarkable change. And I believe that your feet and ankle bones receive strength, and you're going to walk, walking, leaping, praising God, being healed in your body, strengthened in your physical body, made whole in your body, healed in your body, and strengthened in your physical body. And we give you glory. We give you honor. We give you praise for it, Father. Open doors, walking in health. Hallelujah. Let the trumpet sound. Open doors, walking in health. Open doors, walking in healing and strength, perfect soundness and wholeness. And it's all through faith in the name of Jesus, Lord. As I close this morning, I give glory to your name, Lord. It is all because of the mighty, matchless name of Jesus. The name, the name, the name of Jesus. 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 And we give you glory and honor and praise. Now take what you've received and walk in it in the name of Jesus. Take what you've received and walk in it. Take what you've received and walk in it. Take what you've received and walk in it. Take what you've received and walk in it in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Meet the needs of the people, Father. Any other need they may have than physical, it's met today. Your abundant grace, your all-sufficient, all-encompassing favor, your mercies to bless your children. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. As we go into our harvest field, I thank you that you make us agents of change, prophetic ministers of the gospel. And we see the sick healed wherever we go. We see change wherever we go. The word of the Lord is in our mouth to see change wherever we go. And I thank you and praise you, healing ministers. And it comes now, and it manifests, and it ministers. We give you glory in Jesus' name. And in agreement with that, we all said together, amen and amen and amen. God bless you this morning.